Hello everyone, this is Saravanan, Professor, Department of Mechanical Engineering, Erode Segmundar Engineering College. So here in this video, we can study about engineering metallurgy. So first of all, what is meant by engineering metallurgy? So engineering metallurgy basically deals with materials. So here, prerequisite of this particular engineering metallurgy subject is you can have a clear knowledge on physics, chemistry, and some little bit knowledge about mathematics also. You should, with this prerequisite is needed to study this particular material science area. So with this knowledge, we can get a clear understanding about this particular subject. So here, this particular area of material science deals with basic knowledge about internal structure, properties, and processing of materials and its applications. So material science deals with the applications of knowledge with gained by material science to convert into the materials into the product. So how we can convert materials into a product by our day-to-day usage of materials. So here it should clearly told that material science is the basic knowledge about materials, and material science and engineering is a combined resultant activity of materials and knowledge structure and their properties. And finally, the material science deals with knowledge on materials. So what are the kinds of materials? So there are n number of materials available. Basically, metallic material, non-metallic material, and ferrous material and non-ferrous material. In this, ferrous materials means the material having an iron content. So material does not having iron content, that is called non-ferrous materials. So name itself, it shows that ferrous and non-ferrous. Metallic material is composed of one or more metallic elements, that is for example iron, copper, aluminium, etc. And this metallic element may be combined with non-metallic elements also, and then resultant we got a silicon carbide, and that is SiC, and iron oxide Al2O3, etc. And inorganic material have a crystalline structure and very good thermal and electrical conductors also. So basically metals and alloys classified into ferrous and non-ferrous materials. So with this basic knowledge, and there are different kinds of materials, polymeric materials also. In this polymeric material is a organic molecule, and mostly polymeric comes under the category of non-crystalline material. So some of the combination of crystalline and non-crystalline region in this polymeric material having a poor conductor of electricity, because polymeric materials are used as a insulating material, and polymeric material having a strength and ductility is very high, and polymeric material possess low density and low decomposition temperature. Polymeric material basically well known examples are polyvinyl chloride, that is abbreviated as polyvinyl chloride, that is PVC, and polyester. So these are the day to day life we are hearing these kind of words. These applications of polymeric materials are DVDs, appliances, fabric, etc. And there are different types of material, that is next kind of material is ceramic material. So in this ceramic is a bond stuff, that is a refractory material. In this we can also, this kind of material we can hear the word also. In this ceramic material is a combination of metallic and non-metallic element, that is chemically bonded together to give a ceramic material. It's also ceramic material, also inorganic material, but can ceramic material can either crystalline and non-crystalline, or otherwise sometimes ceramic material is the combination of both inorganic and organic material. And ceramic material possesses high strength, high wear resistance, and also it gives high hardness. We can note that ceramic material is a very good insulator. With this insulating property, we can use it for furnace lining and heat treating and melting of metals. And also, ceramic materials are used in a space shuttle to insulate it during the application of space related applications. And ceramic materials used in the kind of abrasive construction materials and also household appliances and utensils. Examples of ceramic, these kind of ceramic materials are porcelain, glass and silicon nitride. And very interesting material, that is composite material. It's also kind of material. Composite material, name itself, it shows that composite. Composite is the combination of two or more material to give a new material. That new material consists of both the basic of combination materials. That is, composite material is a mixture of two or more materials. It consists of filler material and also binding material. So mainly, composite material classified into fibrous, particulate and matrix type. Fibrous materials means fibers are embedded with in matrix, and particles are particle type of kind of materials, that particles embedded in matrix. And here they told that matrix may be metals, ceramics and polymers. That is, there are kind of matrix, that is polymer matrix composite, ceramic matrix composite and metal matrix composites, that is PMC, CMC and MMC. So examples of composite materials are fiber, glass, that is reinforcing material in polyester or epoxy matrix, and concrete, that is a kind of steel rod reinforced with cement and sand. So it's the best example. We have a RCC building that is reinforced with steel, reinforced with cement and sand. So it's also one type of composite material. It is combination of steel rod that reinforced with cement and sand. So this is the good example of composite material. And there are n number of applications of composite materials. It's used on aircraft wings, engine, construction area, and automobiles, etc. And another type of material, that is electronic material. In this silicon and other type of electronic materials, that is commonly used for electrical related applications. Examples are silicon chips, transistor, computers, integrated circuits, IC chips, satellites, etc. And these kind of materials, metallic materials, are used to produce alloys that may be improved, better chemistry and process control. Alloy is a combination of two or more material to give a new material. And aerospace alloys and also some new processing techniques also going on, investigated in the area of material science, metallic materials. And the new trend, metals are used for biomedical applications also, and polymeric materials are used in forecasting growth in every year. There are different kind of polymeric materials that can be blended together to produce a new plastic alloy. And also, ceramic material future trends are, it's a new family of ceramic material that is produced in last two decades. These kind of new materials applied in automobile and biomedical applications, and we are used in the better processing techniques for high impact ceramics that can be found in near future. And future trend of composite materials are fiber reinforced plastics are primary material that is used in composite material. And this annual growth that is predicted in the last decade, that is fiberglass, epoxy and granite epoxy combinations are going in a faster way, and commercial aircrafts are expected to use more kind of composite materials, and future enough future applications and future trend of electric related materials are use of these electronic materials such as silicon, and also electronic materials that is expected to play a vital role in the forthcoming future industrial era, industry 4.0. And there are use of computer related activity and robotics that will increase the resulting in extensive growth in the use of electronic material, and also aluminium for interconnections in the integrated circuits, IC circuits and IC chips that might be replaced by copper by resulting better conductivity. And we talk about smart materials that can change their properties by sensing external stimulus, safe memory alloys, piezoelectric materials. So these kind of safe memory alloys, that material reverts back to the original shape and size with a critical temperature. So this kind of smart material, that is safe memory alloy, that is used in heart valve to expand surgical activities. This kind of smart material, under smart material category, there is piezoelectric material that produce electric field when exposed to force and also and vice versa, that's used to actuators and vibration reducers. So here we talk about MEMS and NEMS, that is micro electromechanical system and nanomaterials, that is MEMS and NEMS. This micro electromechanical system, that is main purpose of creating this kind of micro electromechanical system is, that is we can create a miniature devices and micro pumps, micro sensors, etc. And in the field of nanomaterials, nanomaterials is the there is characteristics length is less than 100 mm, that is 10⁻⁹, that is nanoscience. That is examples of ceramic powder grain size, that is of less than 100 mm. These kind of nanomaterials are harder and stronger than the bulk materials. Nowadays, transistors and diodes that are developed on a nano wire. And there are materials having semiconductor, ceramics are covalent bond, and metals are metallic bond, and polymers are secondary bond with a very good bonding energy. And before going to study these kind of material science and metallurgy, we have a clear understanding about what is meant by face-centered cubic, body-centered cubic, and so on. This is face-centered FCC structure, that is close packed directions are face diagonals. All atoms are identical, that is face-centered atoms that are staggered differently only for ease of viewing. This is hexagonally closed packs body centered cubic structure. This body centered cubic structure, this is all atoms are identical, the center atom is shaded for differently for the purpose of easily viewing. And next one is the hexagonally closed pack structure. And next we move into the some mechanical properties, that is tensile strength, flexural strength, compressive strength, hardness, toughness, fatigue, grip, impact, ductility, malleability. So these are the mechanical strength, mechanical properties. Why we go for testing the materials means, then only we can use in the proper applications, and wherever we need that particular material, we have to test the properties of materials, and then We know the properties thoroughly. Hello everyone. Myself, Dr. N. Saravanan, Professor, Department of Mechanical Engineering, Erode Segmundar Engineering College. In this video, we can talk about engineering metallurgy. Where does material science lie in the broad scheme of things? So there are common types of materials, and here we can talk about scientific and engineering parts of material science and what is meant by material science and engineering. So what are the important goal of material science, and what find the properties of materials? So these things we are going to study in this particular chapter. In this entire globe, there may be space and energy. Energy is full of particles and fields, and particles are classified into atomic and non-atomic matter. In this non-atomic matter, basically have a metal of semi-metal and semiconductor and insulator. In this atomic state of mainly materials, particles filled with viscosity. In this atomic state is basically atomic energy of materials that is classified into gaseous state, solid state, liquid state. In this liquid state may be classified into liquid crystals and solid crystals. Crystals may be classified into amorphous. Based on the structure, it is classified into amorphous, quasi crystals, and rational approximates. And crystals may be nano crystal or nano quasi crystals based on the size and also based on the particle filled with universe. And maybe universe may be in the hyperbolic spherical, and energy may be filled with entropic force, and this kind of an entropy may be strong force weak force and electromagnetic force, and based on the energy is classified mainly based on gravity. Next is, in this based on the phase, the materials can be classified into gaseous state, liquid state, and solid state. It's based on the thermodynamics variables, that is pressure, temperature, enthalpy, entropy, etc. In this, based on the structure, the material science may be classified into crystalline structure, quasi-crystalline structure, and amorphous structures. In this, structure means based on the arrangements of atoms, molecules, and ions. Based on the liquid crystals, in some cases it may be liquid and crystals. Similarly, solid electrolytes, it's also known as fast ion conductor and super ionic conductors, and also it between solid state electrolytes may be between in the crystals and liquids. So these materials have a sublattice which is molten, and the ion in this sublattice are highly mobile. And based on the band structure, the material science may be classified into metals, semi-metals, semiconductors, and insulators. Based on the size, the material science are classified into nano crystals and nano quasi crystals. And another way of classification, we have from the state perspective view, we can have a liquid state, metal state, and based on the structure and conductivity. Or we could have a metal, that is a band structure viewpoint, and metal may be amorphous, that is in this structural point of view. There are common types of engineering materials that are metals, ceramics, polymers, and composites. Here, a composite is the combination of two or more material that gives a new material that gives a certain benefit to at least one property, it's a superior, and we can combine two or more material which gives a new material that gives when compared to base materials. And this hybrid subset of composite gives a new material that give a applications. So these type of atomic entities differ from one of the one class to another, which in turn gives each class that is broad of flavor properties. So in this, common type of materials are metals, ceramics and polymers. And materials are mainly classified into monolithic and hybrids. Monolithic materials are maybe metals and alloys, ceramic and ceramic alloys and glasses, and polymers may be elastomers. Hybrid materials are classified into composites, hybrid may be sandwich, hybrid may be laminate, and hybrid may be lattice or segment. Composite is the two or more solid component. Usually one is the matrix and another one is the composite. In usually one is the matrix and another one is the reinforcement. And in case of sandwich structure, have a material that have a sandwich on the surface, one or more sides of the core material. Lattice may be combination of material and space. So based on the classification, that is based on matrix, there is composite is classified into metal matrix, ceramic matrix and polymer matrix, that is MMC, CMC and PMC. Based on the morphology and the reinforcement, composite material may be classified into particle reinforced composite and fiber reinforced composites and laminated composites. What is here, we can see about what is functionally graded material. In this FGM, that is functionally graded material, is the that property varies from one side of the material to another side, that is structure. For example, outer surface may be made hard, abrasion resistance, while interior may be tough. So this kind of materials are used in various function. This is the name itself, it shows that functionally graded. We can use particular function. For example, gear, outer course may be hard and very tough material, and inner is the fixed with shaft. So inner core material may be some strength and outer core material may be some strength. So based on this property, we can call it as the functionally graded materials. That property varies from one side to side, one side to another side. So this surface may be made hard and abrasion resistance, that is one surface, and another surface interior would be made in a tough material. So this graduation function that could be obtained by composition changes, microstructure differences that that could be obtained in various heat treatment process or various surface modification processes. So common type of materials are ceramics, amorphous, graphite, crystal, metal and polymers. So these are the gradation by using function, that is called the functionally graded material. Metals and alloys, that is copper, nickel, ferrous, NiAl, that is intermetallic component, brass. Brass is the combination of copper and zinc alloy, and ceramic and glasses material. That is usually ceramic and glasses are oxide, nitride, carbide, boride. Oxide may be alumina, that is Al2O3, zirconia, Zr2O3, and nitride may be Si3N4, boride and carbide, that is SiC. And another type of material is polymer. Polymer may be thermoplast, thermosets and elastomers. That is, examples are polyethylene, polyvinyl chloride, that is PVC and polypropylene. Based on the electrical conductivity, materials may be classified into conductor, semiconductor and insulator. Conductor may be copper, aluminium and NiAl. Semiconductor may be Si, GaAs and other things. Alumina, polyethylene comes under the category of dielectrics, that is insulator. Based on the ductility, materials may be classified into ductile and brittle, and metals and alloys are ductile material, and ceramics, inorganic glasses are brittle material. Metal tetrahedron, this material scientists have considered the interwinded concept. which are schematically shown the material tetrahedron, that is called as material tetrahedron. When we can obtain a certain performance, we can expect that certain performance from the component. Component may be material that constituting the same, that is expectation that is put forth to the n number of properties. So that material is synthesized and further made it into the component by set of processing method, that for example casting, forming, welding, sheet metal cutting, powder metallurgy. So these kind of processes, that structure may be fine by using these kind of processing methods, and structure in terms that find the properties which will dictate the performance of the particular component. Hence, each of these aspects depends on the other properties also. So, the main aim, main objective of material science and engineering is to understand the engineer with this tetrahedron. With this tetrahedron means this tetrahedron includes the performance, structural, properties, processing. So, all put together, we can get a clear knowledge and understanding about material science and engineering. Here, what determines the properties of material? Here, small amount of cementite along with grain boundaries that can cause the material to have a superior impact and toughness. So, and also we can dislocations can severely weaken the crystal also. So the some common factors that put together to find the properties of the particular material. First one is the first factor is composition, second one is the phases present and their phases distribution, and third one is the defect structure, but that is called as phases in between the phases, and residual stress that can multiple origins and one may have to travel across length scales. So these are the some properties determine the materials. So these are composition, phase and their distribution, defect structure and residual stress. So in this, many terms and components that will slide. So in this slide, they are giving the many concepts and terms that material scientists that are microstructure engineers that worry about mechanisms. That is, there are a number of factors that is determine the processing, find the state and microstructure of the particular component. There are processing are the casting process, metal forming process, welding, powder processing and machining. This is particular structure depends on the crystal, atom and electromagnetic. Microstructure depends on the thermomechanical treatment, and final component, final product in our hand that depends on the casting, welding, metal forming, sheet metal forming, powder processing, powder metallurgy, based on the machining process also. So these are the factors determine the shape and microstructure of the particular component. That is, microstructure means there is phaseless defects, and also we can add the residual stress and their distributions. Defects may be vacancies, dislocations, spins, stacking sequence, grain boundaries, voids and cracks. So these are the processing parameters that can find the shape and microstructure of the particular component. There are two kinds of structures. That is, first one is the crystal structure and second one is electromagnetic structure. And mainly microstructure can be defined as phases, defect structure and residual stress. And this microstructure can be easily made by thermomechanical treatments also. True. Hello everyone. Myself, Saravanan, Professor Department of Mechanical Engineering, Erode Sengunder Engineering College, Tirupati, Erode. Here, I can give a brief introduction to material science and engineering. So, what is material science and history of material science and engineering? So, materials play a vital role in our culture. It's well connected in our culture, in our day-to-day activities. The development and advancement of societies are dependent on the basic availability of material in our day-to-day life and their materials usage also. So, based on the starting from civilizations, so stone, starting from stone age to in this information era, we are living in our information era, there are n number of n kind of materials used in our day-to-day activities. So, it's clearly understood that materials play a vital role in our day-to-day activity. So, the development and advancement of society are also material play a vital role, that is available of materials and also the materials usage. So in this before Christ and after Christ, that stone age, that is about 35,000 years, bronze age over 1,800 years, and iron age 3,300 years, and polymer age above 50, below 50 years, and concrete age and concrete and the steel age in this less than 60 year, and silicon age less than 35 year. And in this information era, nowadays we are living in, so all ages the availability of materials and their usage because of materials. So materials play a vital role. So with this introduction, we can know what are the materials available, why we can study the materials, why the materials plays a vital role. So initially we are using natural materials. So there are a number of techniques available to produce a new materials with the superior quality. That quality may be obtained in the material processing and also addition of materials to base material. So material science and engineering mainly deals with performance of material. Performance means behavior, how it should be react based on the particular application, and properties of material, that is material characteristics and response to external stimulus and external environment, and also properties like mechanical properties, electrical properties, thermal properties, electromagnetic properties, optical properties, and based on the appearance. And properties play a vital role in the material science and engineering. And based on the method of processing, method of preparing the material play a vital role. And based on the structure, that is internal structure, external structure, based on the components used. So these kind of things studied in our material science and engineering. And there are a number of kinds of materials, that is metals, ceramics, glasses and polymers. These are the classification of materials. In the first one is metals. Metals having a very good conductivity of electricity and heat, and also it gives a very luster appearance, and it's susceptible to corrosive. So metal is a corrosive environment, and metal may be strong, but it is a deformable one. When we come into the ceramic and glasses, so this is the diagrammatic photos of metals. And when we come into the glasses and ceramics having a thermally and electrically insulating material. It's a very good insulating material, and it's a resistance to very high temperature also, and it work in the harsh environments. And it's a ceramics and glasses are very hard material, but it a brittle material. So this is the some pictorial pictures of ceramics and glasses. Next week moving to the polymers. Polymers are very large. Many put it into the form the polymer. Polymers are very large molecules. It's having a low density, low weight, and it polymers may be extremely flexible. So these are the some kind of materials when we used in the applications of polymers. And there are some classification of materials, that is biomaterials, semiconductors, and composites also. Biomaterials is implanted in a human body that's compatible with in our body tissue. So when we go to the hip replacement, we can use these kind of biomaterials also. When we come into the semiconductor category of material, that is electrical and electrical property between conductor and insulators. Between conductor and insulators, semiconductor play a vital role. It can be easily, precisely, and controlled electrical properties. So it can be used in the computers and some electrical hardware and software devices. Next, we move into the material classification, that is composites. Composites consist of more than one material. Composite is the combination of two or more material. When we combine together to form a new material, that new material gives the basic properties of combined materials. So fiber, glass, and other. There are kinds of composite materials, are metal matrix. Based on the matrix and reinforcement, composite classified into metal matrix, ceramic matrix, and polymer matrix composites, that is CMC, MMC, and PMC. Why we can study the materials means, in applied scientists and engineers must make material as the choices. So without selecting a proper material, we cannot go into the application point of view. So as an engineer, we can select the proper material for applications. So when we select the right material, that material should be used in the particular applications. So when we select the right material means, we can know the material property, and based on the material property, we can select the materials. So in service performance, deterioration, and economics point of view, we can select the material. Next one is the for this only we can know with the performance of the material, properties of the material, processing techniques of the material, and structure of the material. So by length scale, structure means subatomic. So this is the metals. So this is the periodic table of the particular elements. This periodic. So any kind of material, when we take it from the earth, in our earth there are plenty of materials available, so we can take it from nature itself. So for extract the material, and then we can process the material and then put it into the particular applications. So these are the n number of elements that is already extracted and put it in a periodic table. So first and foremost kind of the material is metals. Metal having a metallic 1 or 2 or 3 valence electron to combine to bond it together to form a metal. This valent electrons are free from drift through the entire material to form a sea of electrons. So this is the ionic cores. And metals having a non-dielectric bond. Much of main properties of materials metals are, metals having a good conductor of electricity and heat, and also it's metal having a luster, very appearance is not good, but it's having a strong, and also it's a deformable one. Ceramic and glasses having ionic bond. So in this helium, neon, argon, so radon. So these are the periodic table elements. Ceramic and glasses having ionic bond. Ceramic and glasses is the composed with metallic and non-metallic elements, and metallic elements give up the valence electrons to non-metallic elements. So all atoms have filled with the inert gas configuration, and is the simply we can call it as the ionic solid, that is ceramics and glasses. This is the non-directional bond. And polymers having many mers, that is monomers. we can have a polymers having a covalent bond. So here polymers electrons are shared between adjacent atoms. And so here each atoms contribute at least one electron. So here we can easily locate this hydrogen. So this methane, that is methane is the one carbon and four hydrogen, and that is methane, that is CH4. This shared with electron from this hydrogen, shared with electrons from hydrogen, and this hydrogen shared with electrons from carbon. So each electrons are shared between the adjacent atoms that contribute at least one electron. So shared electrons belong to both atoms. So here polymers giving a directional bond. And atomic arrangement, atoms are arranged in the 3D and periodic array that giving a material that is long range order. So here this is the simple atom arrangement, that is simple cubic structure, and this is the body centered cubic, and this is face centered cubic. So this is the hexagonally closed packed structure. So this is called crystalline materials. So these are the structures of crystalline materials. Crystalline materials, that is simple cubic, body centered cubic, and face centered cubic. That is, stacking can affect the properties of the material. For example, anisotropic materials and ductility property of the material. Non-crystalline materials are amorphous materials, are atoms have short range nearest to neighbor order, that is viscous materials, generally complex formulas, that is rabbit. This is isotropic materials. This is the atomic structure, atomic pictorial representation of non-crystalline materials. And microstructure of when we compare the microstructure of single crystalline and polycrystalline material, in this single crystal material is the periodic arrangements of atoms that extends throughout the entire sample. And this single crystal microstructure is difficult to grow, environment must be tightly controlled. And also this single crystal materials are anisotropic materials, and polycrystalline materials are many small crystals or grains are bonded together in a small crystals. This is oriented with the with respect to one another. Here the several crystals are initiated and grow towards each other. So this is polycrystalline materials are anisotropic and isotropic materials. So this is the levels of structure in the length scale, that is subatomic, atomic, microscopic, and bulk material. So subatomic materials is 0.2 nanometer to 1 nanometer. This is atomic materials are 0.2 to 10 nanometer, and microscopic materials are 1 to 1000 micrometer, and less above 1 mm, that is called the bulk material. So structure depends on the material properties, or depends on the structure processing properties and performance. And here bulk properties may be mechanical, electrical, thermal, and optical properties. Mechanical properties may be elastic modulus, shear modulus, and hardness. Electrical properties may be conductivity, resistivity, and capacitance. Thermal property, that is heat, thermal expansion, heat capacity, thermal conductivity. Optical property may be reflectivity, absorption, and emission. So any material processing structure and properties, finally performance is main goal, that is increased strength from a metallic material. So these are the some processing of materials. And next we go to the some characterization techniques of the material. That is, first one is the optical microscopy. When we use the reflected light, based on the reflected light, the transparent material can use the transparent light to use to study the microstructure of the material. So this is called the light microscopy. Next is electron microscopy. So here, so just right. Welcome to everyone. Myself, Saravanan, Professor Department of Mechanical Engineering, Erode Segmental Engineering College, Tirupati, Erode. Here in this video, we can talk about engineering metallurgy. So being a mechanical engineer, having a sound knowledge on material science and metallurgy and engineering materials is important. So because engineer have to select the right material for right applications. So for that only we are study the engineering metallurgy subject. So based on this, we can have a knowledge on alloys and phase diagram. So before that, there are some terms, that is, what is my phase diagram and what are the alloy system. In this phase diagram is a graphical representation of phase changes between one phase to another phase, that is equilibrium state to another state, and ice to, for example, ice to water, water to water vapor. This is the phase changes in between one system to another system. In this phase diagram, there is providing a graphical means of presenting result of experimental studies of complex natural process in a given system with this temperature and pressure for a specific system at equilibrium are the phases present that can be determined. A system may be any portion of entire globe which of an interest that can be studied in experimentally. In this phase diagram, phase is the particular portion of the system which is physically homogeneous and has a specific composition and mechanically separated from any other phase in the particular system in the globe. And equilibrium means, that is the equilibrium state or equilibrium conditions, minimum energy of the system, that the state of the reaction that will not change with the time provided that pressure and temperature is kept at the constant phase. And component is the smallest number of independent variable chemically constituent necessary to define a phase in the particular system. Component may be oxide, element, mineral, and it depends on the system being examined. Whatever system may be examined, that depends on the, that gives the component. That, for example, if we examine the H2O system, that shows the phases which appear over a temperature and pressure in the range of ice, liquid, water, and water to water vapor. That is ice to liquid, liquid to water, water to water vapor. So these are the phase changes in the particular system. So the composition of each phase in H2O and only one chemical parameter component that needed to describe the particular composition of each phase. So for that we have a phase rule, Gibbs phase rule. In this phase system, P plus Fc is equal to C plus 2. Here P is the number of phases present in the particular system, C is the component that making creating a phase, and F is the degrees of freedom. And the degrees of freedom that may be represent the environmental conditions that can be independently varied without changing the number of phases in the particular system. That is, that conditions include that temperature, pressure, chemical composition, and other parameters. And finally, we conclude that these are the fundamental definitions of the particular system. That is, phase is the homogeneous, physically distinct portion of the particular system. That phase may be liquid phase, solid phase, and gaseous phase. And component is the pure chemical substance that, for example, element or component, H2O is the one of the component or a compound. And degrees of freedom that state the variables which can be changed, that is continuously or independently. For example, degrees of freedom may be pressure, temperature, and composition of the particular system. Constituents is the association of phases that distinct phases with a distinct melting point. And its may be constituent is the eutectic, eutectoid, peritectic, and peritectoid system. And composition is the fraction of one components to all components. It may be in terms of weight or atoms. And here there is P is the number of phases present in the particular system, and F is the number of degrees of freedom, and C is the number of components present in the system. So this is the phase rule, P plus f is equal to c plus 2. And here on diagram, this shows the drawn in between the temperature versus weight. And if we increase the temperature, the phases may be solid to liquid. And also, if we add a weight percentage, this is partial solid solubility phase diagram, example of phase diagram. And traditionally, we can calculate in the form of weight, and modern we can calculate in the atomic moles. And next, we move into the cast iron. Cast iron may be used in place of instead of steel. Instead of steel, we are using cast iron also, because considerably for we go to the economically cost saving process, we can use cast iron instead of steel. The design and production advantages of cast iron that include low tooling and low production cost, low manufacturing cost, good machinability without burring, and ability to cast into complex irregular shapes also. And cast irons have a excellent, very good wear resistance, and cast irons have a high hardness, particularly white cast iron. And cast irons having inert damping abilities, and cast iron possess the properties of cast iron that possess chemical composition of the ion, rate of cooling of the cast iron into the mold, and type of cast iron formed. So these are the factors the cast iron properties are affected. And type of cast irons are gray cast iron, white cast iron, malleable cast iron, and nodular cast iron, that may ductile cast iron. First one is gray cast iron. Gray cast iron is one of the oldest and most commonly used in the form of cast iron. Gray cast iron is named its appearance, because of its fracture appearance, they are giving name it as gray cast iron. It contains carbon in the form of flake graphite in the matrix, which consists of ferrite, pearlite, and a mixture of ferrite and pearlite. And the flake-like shape of graphite gray cast iron that exerts a dominant influence on its mechanical properties. So these flakes give the graphite flake gray cast iron. This is the pictorial presentation, that is microscopic, electronic microscopic view of gray cast iron, and this is the microscopic view of gray cast iron. Advantages of using gray cast iron are very high damping capacity and good bearing quality to graphite. There are limitations of using this gray cast iron are it's a brittle material, that is low impact strength, and so because of this brittleness, low impact strength, it can be limited use of limited applications, that is used in critical applications. In case of critical area, we can limitedly use this gray cast iron. And in this gray cast iron, graphite acts as a void. So this void creation, it reduces the strength. So maximum we recommended design stress is 1/4 of ultimate tensile strength. And low gray cast iron, that enables gray cast iron to be used in higher duty applications. And advantages of low alloy gray cast iron are the improvement in strength, corrosion resistance, heat and wear resistance are also combination of strength, corrosion and wear resistance. And next is the pictomicroscopic view of white cast iron. And this white cast iron is the unique in that only member of the cast iron family which carbon is present only as a carbide. Due to this absence of graphite, this it gives the light in appearance. This is the microscopic view of white cast iron. And next one is the chilled cast iron. The localized area of gray cast iron is cooled very rapidly from the melting itself. Then finally the cast iron is formed at the place that can be cooled, that is called the chilled cast iron. This chilled cast iron that can be produced by adjusting carbon composition of white cast iron so that the normal cooling rate of the at the surface is just fast enough to produce the white cast iron, while slower cooling rate below the surface that will produce the gray cast iron. This is the scanning electron microscopy or transmission electron microscopic image of chilled cast iron. Next one is ductile, that is cast iron, that is ductile cast iron. Another name is model nodular cast iron. This structure is developed from the melting itself. The carbon forms into the spheres when the magnesium, sodium and other elements are added to melt up iron with very low sulfur content will exhibit the carbon at the stage of forming. So this is the spherical carbon nodule with matrix form the nodular cast iron, that is also called as ductile cast iron. Because of this economic advantage, it's having a high reliability. Ductile iron is used for critical automotive components like crankshaft, engine connecting rod, wheel hubs, drag axles, front wheel spindle supports, disc brakes, calipers, suspension system parts, power transmission yokes, high temperature applications for turbo housing and manifolds, and high security valves for many applications. So the cast iron pipes, the industry is another major user of the ductile cast iron. So this is the next one is the malleable cast iron. This cast iron is cooled rapidly. The graphite flakes are needed to gray cast iron. So at the end of the cooling process, the free carbon is released. This free carbon is referred to as the tempered carbon, and this process is called malleable etching. So this is the scanning electron microscopic metallurgical microscopic image of malleable cast iron. This is the ferritic malleable cast iron, and this one is the ferritic malleable cast iron. So these are the types of cast irons. And next we move into the low carbon low alloy steels. As per American Iron and Steel Institute ASI defines the carbon steel in the form of no minimum content is specified or needed to form a chromium, cobalt and niobium, molybdenum, nickel, titanium, tungsten, vanadium, zirconium or any other element to be added minimally to obtain the particular alloying effect. So when specified, the minimum for copper does not exceed that particular percentage. When the maximum content specified are the some small elements. So this steel can be classified by variety of different systems that depends on the composition and manufacturing method, finishing method, product form and microstructure, and based on the heat treatment. So based on this classification, there is steel can be classified into plain carbon steel, plain low carbon steel, medium carbon steel, high carbon steel, low alloy steel, high alloy, corrosion resistant, heat resistant and wear resistant steel. And ferrous alloy, that is classified in terms of ferritic, pearlitic, martensitic and austenitic structures. Low carbon steel means it's contained up to a very low percentage of carbon, that is 0.30% of carbon. And medium carbon steel, it's a low carbon steel typically used in automobile body panels and wire products. Medium carbon steel, it's similar to low carbon steel, except that the carbon ranges from 0.3 to 0.60. That is, it's mainly used in rails, railway wheels and rail axles. High carbon steels having contained 0.6 to 1% carbon with manganese, that contents range from 0.3 to 0.9%. That is high carbon steel that is used in spring materials with high strength wires. And ultra high carbon steel, it's a containing alloying elements 1.2.25 to 2% of